I'm Kirk Allison. I direct the program in human rights and health in the School of Public Health. I'm standing in for Alex Loubet, who is not able to be here today, and I'm very glad to welcome Ravi Malhotra, who is associate professor of law at the University of Ottawa, and he'll be discussing E.T. Kingsley and the legal politics of disablement. Professor Malhotra has a BA with joint honors in political science and law from Carleton University, Ontario, and an MA in international affairs as well, also from Carleton. He has an LLB, that's an undergraduate law degree from the University of Ottawa, and an LLM from Harvard. He's a doctor of juridical sciences from the University of Toronto, and he's been of the bar in Ontario since 2001. He's a member of the Human Rights Committee of the Council of Canadians with Disabilities. Amongst other things, he's researched for disability rights with an organization called REACH, taught international human rights at the Western Ontario Faculty of Law. Among his several interests, his primary interests include labor and employment law, human rights, globalization, and disability law. His publications have appeared in the Journal of Law and Equity, the Harvard International Law Journal, Supreme Court Law Review, and others. He's written on John Rawls and disability rights in a recent volume on critical disability theory with the University of British Columbia Press. And he currently has two book projects. One is an empirical study with Moran Rowe based on interview data with young adults with disabilities, which will be published with Routledge. And the other is a biography of E.T. Kingsley with Benjamin Isset, which will come out with a university, I wrote Columbia, but that's not correct.
It's the University of British Columbia.
Of British Columbia. I left out the British Columbia. And that brings us to today's topic, which actually has a Minnesota connection with Eugene T. Kingsley, who was born in 1856 in the U.S. There'll be more on his birth. And his connection was as a brakeman on the St. Paul-based Northern Pacific Railway, which ran a line from the Minnesota to the Pacific coast, and its labors began really in 1864 with a land grant of 130,000 square kilometers from Congress on the transcontinental railway. Kingsley was involved in a rail accident, and he had at least both feet amputated, and he thereafter became a socialist in California. And worked also, had some contact with the American socialist Daniel De Leon, but they had a falling out, and subsequently he founded the Socialist Party in Canada in 1904, which was the first socialist party in Canada. Amputation or no, Kingsley was an imposing figure of some 250 pounds, and with rather boundless energy. And with that, I'd like to invite Professor Ravi Malhotra and welcome him to the University of Minnesota and Institute of Advanced Studies, as he'll enlighten us on E.T. Kingsley and the legal politics of disablement.
Well, thanks so much for having me here at the university. So this is loud enough for everyone, and I hope you can all hear me. So yes, I want to acknowledge, first of all, the role of my co-author, Ben Isett. Dr. Isett's been instrumental in all of this, isn't here with me in Minnesota. I'm here to do archival work, but he brings the historian side to this talk, and I bring the legal side to it. And of course, you know, once you start looking for legal issues, you find them, but they are definitely here in this presentation. And what you'll find is that it's an intersection of at least three different types of history, probably more, but the three I'd highlight are disability history, legal history, and then labor history, / radical social movements. So in a sense, this project began some years ago. This is funded by SHRC, which is a Canadian government agency that funds social science research, which enables me to do archival trips to Minnesota to gather this research. This has gone on for some time. But because there's sufficient time, I'll just start out with a little background of where this project came from. But before I do that, I do want to acknowledge Alex's wonderful mentorship. Invited me to give this talk, and he wanted to convey his disappointment he wasn't able to attend as he recovers from his spinal surgery. He asked me not to keep all this confidential, and he wanted this all disclosed, and how much he regrets not being able to be here. But the good news is he's doing well medically and should be back at the university in a few months. Okay, so to start at the beginning, I came across this name when I was reading a book by Ian MacKay called Reasoning Otherwise, a history of the Canadian left social movements. And being someone who's born with a disability and does legal disability rights analysis, it just struck me as really interesting that this man was around, yet there's only one line sentence here, you know, about his disability. There's no further information. And if you go through the literature, you'll see the name Kingsley over and over again with a disability mentioned, but not detailed. So it'll say the crippled Kingsley or the disabled Kingsley or whatever, the legless Kingsley, but it won't elaborate, yeah, and other things. It won't elaborate on, I think one of them is the legless wonder, is one of, you know, but they won't really articulate any kind of commentary on how this came to be. And so I went around and asked people what to do about this, being someone who has legal background, but no real historical skills. So I teamed up with a historian. Some historians told me to forget about it. And I soon discovered, you know, I think in some cases they just weren't all that interested in this topic. Other people told me, do it, but it will take you years of searching in archives before you're able to do it. That turned out to be more correct than I would have liked. And to the point that when I was preparing this talk, I found new information in the process of arriving in Minnesota. In the last few days, I've actually found new information. So this is a constantly moving target. And so let me try to begin at the beginning, and hopefully it'll become clear to you. And I will try to answer the question of who is E.T. Kingsley and why should you care? Because presumably that is on your mind, and I want to keep you here. So hopefully I will sustain your interest. So disability history generally is a field that is still in its infancy. It's certainly interdisciplinary, but it's at a very early stage despite the release of important books such as Kim Nielsen's much-anticipated Disability History of the United States, and back in 2006, a special issue of Radical History Review devoted to the topic of disability. But like the comment I made flippantly about law, I think you could quite seriously say about disability, and it's quite true, as Douglas Bainton, prominent disability historian, observed in 2001, and I quote, "Disability is everywhere in history once you begin looking for it, but conspicuously absent in the histories we write." And I think that is really true, and so really, it was my commitment to equality rights, equal protection, as you'd say in the States, for disability, that I wanted to bring to light a man who is a political leader and yet has been completely lost. And so for an American audience, I'll begin at the end to just let you know that Socialist Party of Canada is virtually unknown today in Canada. It dies in the 1920s, before Kingsley even dies, and it is not a party that is well known. Kingsley's name has been lost, and ultimately what I'd like to do finalize, get through peer review and get the book out for the book contract with Ben Isaac for UBC Press. But ultimately, I'd like to, hopefully with Ben, make a documentary film of his life, except we have no filmmaking skills and no money. So those are sort of constraints. So we're trying to work around that. But I think it's a very attractive topic just because it intersects so many different things. And so if nothing else, I hope you will leave here with an interest of wanting to know more about E.T. Kingsley and his life, because it's certainly not something that's very straightforward. It's complicated and it's nuanced. As I said, this book is under contract, which means it hasn't been really yet. We're at UBC Press, able to lead the legal politics of disablement and the political life of E.T. Kingsley. So this is my sabbatical year. If we're lucky, I'm hoping, Ben and I are hoping this book will be out by 2015. That's an optimistic look. But he's an American-Canadian scholar, or activist, or both, you could say. Worker scholar is the way I would articulate, because I don't think you should use the word scholar for academics. Kingsley was never someone who was formally exclusively for academics. Kingsley is someone who was a worker scholar. He articulated his ideas to the working class, even though, as far as we can tell, we've looked, he doesn't seem to have had any formal education. So, as I said, it has significant implications for disability history, labor history, and of course also for legal history. His case as a radically disabled person is not completely unique. You may know from the life of Helen Keller, and I mentioned before Kim Nielsen, she also has a biography of Helen Keller. If you don't know the other side, if you just thought Helen Keller was this wonderful blind deaf lady, there is this other side to the rabble-rouser Helen Keller, who was a radical socialist. Not everyone knows this. So, I mean, you know, and you can read work like that, but it nevertheless is a relatively unique case. The Kingsley case, and it raises questions about how do we think about disablement, how do we think about history, and how do we think about law. As in all my work, this is profoundly influenced by the social model of disablement. So it stands for the proposition that it is structural barriers that affects the lives of people with disabilities. So it's not a narrative about pity, it's a narrative about structural barriers, even though it's not at all clear. And I've already had this in the work I have published in Review of Disability Studies on my own, how Kingsley thought about his own disability. We don't know, because he didn't keep a diary that we found, to the best of our knowledge. Although he does have, apparently, has a grandson in the Minneapolis area named Donald Kingsley, who died in 1980. But we've yet to be able to discover anything on that, on the genealogical side. So this is a multifaceted international research project, and there's so many roots. Eventually, you go for the low-hanging fruit because you know. And that's why I have historians, specifically Ben Isaac, but also a team of RAs. Because I have government funding to do this, I have a team of 14 RAs that have worked on this in both countries for a very long time. So if I come out with ideas as a lawyer that are totally bizarre, and I have. Some ideas are just weird. So at one time I wanted to find out whether he might have spoken on the radio, and then they told me, "No, you're never going to find radio transcripts. That's a non-starter." And so, you know, so if I say things that are totally bizarre, the historians keep me in check on things towards lines of research that make more sense. So what this means in a historical context is complex. Because Kingsley apparently never espoused a particular theory of disability or even reflected on it in public. Although, and as I said, we just found the first commentary of other people that worked with him politically saying that they think his theory is of socialism is so critical of unions because he is somebody who is outside the workplace. That is something that I could have a field day as a disability scholar analyze, and we actually found it buried somewhere in the archives, saying he and another fellow apparently sit all day in the Labor Temple Saloon drinking and arguing politics, and that they're, it actually says this, and that they're so critical of the Delaneyist leadership for not being orthodox enough, which if you know the history of socialism, the Delaneyists were super orthodox. So it kind of boggles the mind that Eugene Debs breaks with the Delaneyists to form the more pragmatic socialist party of the United States, which had some, before it gets completely destroyed by McCarthyism, it had some kind of influence in places like Wisconsin and Minnesota, more than other places. But this is not Debs' socialism, the pragmatic sewer socialism, you know, build sewers, let's get into municipal planning. This is not it. This is, we will elect a government that is pure socialist, nationalize all property, and make everything a socialist collective. This is Delaneyism. But because Delaney had some orientation to the unions, Kingsley found that even to be too pragmatic. Okay, I'm coming to that. I will come to that momentarily. So I use critical disability theory to illuminate how Kingsley faced both opportunities and constraints in three areas of law that directly affect his life: tort law, immigration law, and national security law. And if you're wondering if this is all fortuitous, a lot of this is luck. I did not know that Kingsley was a successful tort claimant when I started the project. I just guessed that you know, maybe he sued, and we'll see where this project goes. I'll probably get tenure anyway, and that's what it was, purely a gamble. And then the tenure part worked out, but it turns out that he does sue, and he sues for $85,000. And I'm going to come, but I want, you know, I don't know how many of you are familiar with the history of inflation, because it sounds very unimpressive, but there is an inflation website you can get from Google going back to 1913. And so I'm using 1913 data, even though his accident's in 1891. And I will go over this, I promise, at some point. But, I'll put it in this background. You can read. Does anybody want me to read this out? If anybody needs that, I'm happy to do that. But it's in the background. This is, he moves around a lot. That's sort of what you can take from his early life. But I just wanted to communicate, before I get into the narrative, is that $85,000 in 1891 is, as far as I can tell, in 1913 dollars, which is the earliest figure I can get. So a fortiori more in 1891 dollars is about 3 million. So this is why I've traveled to Minnesota, is to go through the Northern Pacific archives, because if some guy, and Kingsley is not a public figure at this point, some guy is suing you for $3 million, presumably it's in the corporate archives, that there's some record of this. He gets $5,000 ultimately from the jury, which is still a huge amount of money, and it's still enough probably to buy a mansion. But he wanted $85,000. So that's an enormous figure, and it may well have shaped how railways think about workplace injuries, because there's no workman's compensation. I'm using the sexist term deliberately, because this is men who get injured. This is before the feminist era. So workman's compensation doesn't exist in this time period. This is before any of that. If you're injured, you sue and hope you win. And a study by Crystal Eastman, who was a pioneering feminist lawyer, very unusual at the time. She did a pioneering study around 1910, some decades later, and she says that in cases involving death, which is not Kingsley's case, only about 3% around 1910 get more than $2,000, and Kingsley gets $5,000. So he's, despite the fact he gets 1/17 of what he asked, he is in the very, very top quadrant of successful tort claimants, which is not, and this is, I'm not even a tort scholar. This is just icing on the cake for me. I mean, in terms of it just worked out happily, and so a lot of this is just sort of fortuitously worked out. So unfortunately, E.T. Kingsley has only been given sporadic mention in the Canadian labor history literature, and virtually none in the American. So he is, if you haven't picked up on this already, he is an American Canadian. Yeah, so that sort of gives you the sort of brief background. He does spend time in Minnesota. He is married to Almira Doan in River Falls, which is not very far from Minneapolis, but he lives, and his kids, or at least one of his kids, is born in Minnesota. But there's a bifurcation in his life, or a couple of different bifurcations. One of them essentially is disablement. So although we don't know who left whom, I have to confess, I thought that his partner, or wife is probably more accurate to say, left him, but that may not be the case, given that we now know he had the tort settlement. It could be he just left her and moved to California, but the marriage seems to have split at the time of the disablement after he was injured in Montana. The family's remaining in Minnesota. It looks like, well, the accident takes place in Montana, so he's hospitalized at the railway hospital in Montana, and the second part of his life begins, which is a radical in the Delaney Socialist Labor Party on the streets, doing very radical things for the era as a double amputee. That in itself, to me, justifies the book. It's an extraordinary story. He then goes on to Canada and becomes a leader of political party in Canada in 1902. So it raises all kinds of questions. But to give you a brief synopsis of some of the basics, and just let me know, I'm already way behind. You just let me know, tell me when it's 5 minutes, and I'll cut off. Because I could talk for hours, and I want to give you time for questions. So basically, he lived in many different states that parallels a sort of manifest destiny narrative of U.S. history. What do I mean by that? In that he constantly moves west. If you can see, he's born in New York State. By a very early age, you can see he's in Illinois. Then he lives in Morristown, Minnesota. He's living in all of Ohio. The 1890 census is destroyed in a fire. It's the bane of American historians. We don't know. The Commerce Department didn't protect the census because it wasn't backed up. There were no computers. There was no way to back it up. So it got destroyed in a census fire. And so we all suffer the loss. We don't know where he is in 1890. But we do know that the injury takes place. And so he nearly dies. And if you look at the Montana newspaper reports, it was not thought that he would actually survive at the time. But he does survive, becomes a radical, and joins the Delanist Socialist Labor Party. As I said, he does get married. The Doans are a family of Pennsylvania Quakers. We did try to do as much genealogy as we could, but it didn't really go anywhere. So, I mean, I don't know what we're going to do with that. But he has two kids, Percy, born around 1881, and Robert in 1884. And there may be living descendants. As I said, we haven't fully worked that out. Some of his kids didn't seem to have. They weren't fertile enough to benefit this project, unfortunately. So it seems some of the Kingsley line dies out. But he does seem to have, it's possible he has living great-grandchildren in the Minnesota area. We just don't know. As I said, by 1880, the family has moved to Olive, Ohio. He's back in the 1880s in Minnesota. And then we have the transformative event in Spring Gulch. I love the sound of that name. Spring Gulch, Montana, the very western part of the state. He's injured near St. Regis, October 1890, while working for a brakeman, as it was said in the introduction, and originally it was not thought that he would survive. His limbs are mangled, and they must be amputated after a series of operations. So the great puzzle for me at this point is, how is it that there's so little mention of this? There are many, many reports that describe him in Canada and the States and never mention his disability. And one report, and I'm very conscious of not being anachronistic, not putting historians back, technology backwards, where it's not historically accurate. But I started researching this because one singular reference talks about the fact that he seemed to have artificial limbs, and I was very skeptical because but it turns out that artificial limbs, like the pirate stories that you all hear about as children, artificial limbs have a longer history. They go back hundreds of years, longer than the history of spinal cord injury or anything else, and it actually is possible. Because we've documented it in the history of science, that artificial limbs existed. And I don't want to take the GLBT or queer theory of passage, because that implicates a whole set of philosophy that I don't want to get into, and I'm not sure it's accurate the way he saw his life. But it could be that even if he wasn't consciously trying to pass, that he had artificial limbs that a casual observer may not have realized he had a disability, which has all kinds of interesting implications. For he was a double amputee, but he seemed to ambulate with artificial limbs and do things like run for Congress, and it's fairly extraordinary. So as I said, he was hospitalized in Missoula, Montana, in a category of institution that no longer exists, the railway hospital. Although you can get postcards, and the hospital was burnt down later on. We don't think Kingsley had anything to do with the fact that it burnt down a couple of years after. Although he is radicalized politically at the time. It's interesting. So I don't know what to do with that. But we do know the hospital burns down, and at some point after his release, he sues for $85,000. He gets $5,000. And in fact, I think I did mention this earlier, his first appearance for somebody who becomes a relatively prominent Canadian figure and widely known at the time, although lost today among Canadians in the Canadian media, his first appearance is not after 1902. That's I haven't come to that. That's the central dynamic in his life, is that separates the American period from the Canadian period. But his first appearance in the Canadian press is 1891. Why? Because the Canadian media covered his litigation against Northern Pacific. Why? I don't know. I really don't know, but I think it's because 85,000 was such a large figure and Winnipeg was the newspaper city that covered it. The Winnipeg Free Press covers it. Winnipeg headquartered railways at the time. And I think that, without being too doctrinaire, I think the railway bourgeoisie, if you want to use the terminology, saw this litigation for 85,000. It was actually of interest to them. If they're going to start facing this, workmen's compensation debates were starting to grow on both sides of the border. So so you have this, both the Winnipeg Free Press and the St. Paul Daily Globe, which was a major paper at the time, reported this, and that's Kingsley's entry into the public discourse. And ironically enough, you get more details from the Canadian story than the American. Why that is, again, it's a mystery, but the Winnipeg Free Press says that his left leg was removed between the knee and the hip, and the right leg between the ankle and the knee. according to newspaper reports, I'm going tomorrow to try to find the court records, but his case is apparently eventually transferred to federal court, and a jury awards him $5,000 in 1892. But he ambulanced, as I said, with artificial limbs and a cane, and there's countless reports for the rest of his life, which is a very long life, but which doesn't refer to his disability. So I can only surmise that the casual observer either didn't mention it out of politeness around disability rhetoric of the era, or they didn't notice. And I'm not sure which it is. I'm thinking it's the latter, but I don't know. It remains a mystery. So you can see some of this. This is the later period. He moves no later than 1894 to California. And some of you may be familiar with an organization called the IWW, the Industrial Workers of the World. It's a very important union. They pioneered free speech fights, which is campaigns before the modern U.S. Supreme Court understanding of the First Amendment and free speech was regulated. The IWW, which still exists, now they do things like organize punks, and you know they do other things today, the modern IWW. But the historic IWW was a real union. I mean, they organized workers in industry and pioneered the free speech fight. Kingsley was doing this in the 1890s in San Francisco, and we have not found much literature or any literature to date about the San Francisco free speech fight. Kingsley seems to have been a pioneer. I'm not saying it doesn't exist. It may well exist. We just haven't found it. But all the literature I've found about free speech fights talks about Spokane, Washington, 1909, talked a much later period. Kingsley was a pioneer doing this in a city where there, at least as far as we can tell, there's not a lot of literature on this. So, you know, I have a lot to say about workplace injuries, but I'm going to skip that and come back to that if I run out of time, if I have time, which I don't think will be a problem. So, you know, you can just let me, I'm already seem to have taken up, we started a bit late, but, you know, just if I go another 15 minutes, is that too much?
Okay,
just, you know, just let me know how, and I'll come back. I have some theories of workman's compensation. That's more legal doctrine. I think it would bore you. So I'll come back to that if we have, or maybe in the discussion period about workman's compensation. But I'm going to skip ahead. So this is the political period of Kingsley's life. He's a man who had very little education, but by the 1890s, he's pioneering free speech fights. And skip ahead to the... So you can see, this is... I don't know how you can see that at all, but is that visible? You can. Free speech is suppressed, is what it says. The authorities have decided that straight speaking at meetings disturb the peace. The regular advertised meeting of the Socialist Labor Party, 7th and Market Streets, will be held on Saturday evening, August 29th. No speaking. Absolute silence will prevail. So this is sort of a radical protest. The sort of the school kid version is you have a First Amendment that comes from George Washington and everyone lived happily ever after. That really actually isn't really how the First Amendment played out. It's more, it was a contested process. But even the free speech fight literature, none of it refers to San Francisco that I've seen. If I'm wrong, please tell me, you know, but I've not seen any literature that refers to the Delaneist Socialist Labor Party. Most of it refers to the IWW, which isn't even founded for another decade. Is found, and as I said, now organizes punks and does other strange things. But now, anyway, but the historic IWW was a real union. I mean, they did real stuff in the community. This is an earlier period. Kingsley was a pioneer on this. So, you know, so he was a changed man, a radical living on his own. His marriage seems to have fallen apart. We don't know the details of that, apart from the fact that his family seems to visit him in 1913. So, and in his death certificate, he's listed as married. So it looks like he was never formally divorced. But the death certificate has numerous errors, which sort of is symbolic of the isolation that an elderly, disabled man, I think, experiences. It says he's British, which isn't true. And we know it's not true. But that I think, just reflects the isolation of his life. He breaks with the Delaneists. And as I said, in the late 1890s, forms his own sect in Washington State, we think, and then moves to Nanaimo on Vancouver Island in 1902. But in the 1890s, he does run twice for the House of Representatives. And this is the dominant radical party. Is it huge? Well, no. But they did have meetings in San Francisco in English, French, German, Yiddish, and Italian. You know, so, yeah, and Yiddish. It's a very significant organization at the time. These are impossibilists. They are not like Eugene Debs reform socialism. They weren't electoral. They weren't Bolsheviks. They wanted to use the electoral process without getting too much into the theory. They wanted to have elections, but if they took power, they wanted to abolish all of capitalism completely. They weren't gradualist socialists. So they opposed struggles for reform. And eventually Kingsley concludes that, so even things like unions, they're dismissive of unions because they see them as just, the jargon is commodity struggles. Unions are just about commodity struggles. We're real socialists. You know, one of the slogans, jumping ahead as I do, of the Socialist Party of Canada is, no kidding aside, their slogan is no compromise, no political trading. This is radical stuff. They're one of these people that has a sort of one-point program, which is to abolish all wage labor, abolish capitalism, and eliminate surplus value by seizing all of the means of production. That's their program, basically. But interestingly enough, they want to do this electorally. They're not Bolshevik insurrectionists. They actually want to do this by getting elected to office. So, thankfully, the Delaneyists continue in the United States, and because they obsessively archive everything, I'm able to do this research. You know, on the American side, it's much easier to actually archive, analyze the American archives, because they have documented so much going back so far. So I've already talked about the free speech fights. As I said, later on in Spokane, Fresno, San Diego, a number of other cities, the free speech fights become more prominent. But in 1895-96, they were hugely, the SLP, Socialist Labor Party, was hugely influential in the San Francisco free speech fights on Market Street, as you can see. And Kingsley himself was arrested at one point and demands a jury trial. Is this influenced by the fact that he just won 6 years? Because we studied this part, we found this before we knew about the tort jury verdict. And as a Canadian, it's also doubly weird. You have to understand that we don't have tort juries in Canada. Juries in Canada are strictly for criminal issues. He already had a civil jury in the United States give him $5,000. We've never been able to figure out what happened with that particular case. As far as we can tell, it just gets dropped. He doesn't go to prison at this point, but he continues on being a radical. We have reports from the San Francisco Labor Council condemning the arrest of a socialist in August 1896. And in the meantime, we have Kingsley running for the House twice in 1896 and 1898 before he has this falling out after a face-to-face meeting with Daniel DeLion. He apparently says DeLion is not orthodox enough. He's too oriented towards the unions. Which is interesting, because DeLaid is about the most orthodox Marxist, I think, that ever lived in the United States. Kingsley wants a more orthodox party. He seems to hightail it to Puget Sound in the Washington State area, and then moves to Canada. But just to give you a flavor, and this is from a mainstream newspaper, you have to understand that newspapers were very much like TV in that era, right? Because there is no TV. And so they have a lot more colorful detail as opposed to now TV. I saw on my hotel TV there were three different stories about murders, about somebody who, it's all infotainment now. So the role of the media has changed. In the 1890s, it was very scholarly compared to what you have today. So one of the things that the SLP wanted to do was a California-wide tour to educate the working class about the Delaneyist program. Kingsley was one of the men that wanted to do it. So if you don't mind, I'm just going to read a little quotation from this. And I wasn't able to kind of paste that illustration, but I'll just read it to you. So this describes the caravan that was going to travel through California. And it says, mounted upon a heavy running gear is a little house, 10 feet 8 inches in length by 6 feet wide and 6 feet high. In the sides are 6 windows for light and air. The interior is neatly and packly fitted up. It contains two cupboards and several little cubbyholes for storing away necessary articles. The bed is a woven wire mattress in an iron frame, which in the daytime is hoisted and fastened to the ceiling, and at night it is let down and rests on the boxes over the wheels. In the front end is the cook stove of the camporder, and under the driver's seat all the necessary provisions will be carried. A tin box the width of the wagon is placed under the footrest that will serve as a wardrobe for the traveler's extra clothing. The entire wagon is painted red, of course. In the east, the socialist red flag is displayed from the top of this class of vehicles, but no flag will be carried on Mr. Hasdell's house on wheels. Mr. Hasdell will be provided with shotguns and fishing tackle to provide himself with amusement and is larger with food. A pair of stout horses will be attached to the rig. Okay, so that's just giving you a flavor of the kind of era. It raises all kinds of questions as part of the IAS's program. I was very generously provided an opportunity to do a TV interview, which will be on Bat of Minerva at some point. So you can go check the website about that. But one of the things that came out, I think is not actually on the tape, but it's a very interesting fellow that does the hosting. And so we just started chatting afterwards. And he was talking about automobiles. And of course, how automobiles improved the quality of life for a lot of people. But for disabled people, and when I say automobiles, I'm talking about the post-Eisenhower, sort of the American society, where you can't really, like I have relatives, my brother is a US citizen, so I have relatives in Texas, where you literally can't buy bread, or milk without a motor vehicle. You can't literally do anything. But in Kingsley's time, having a disability sociologically, the social model, it meant something different because nobody had a car in the 1890s. I mean, there just were no cars. And even when they were invented, I don't think many people, particularly on the Canadian side, I don't think there's a huge lag, but I think there might be a little one. So he moves to British Columbia. And what I've researched is that, except maybe for the mayor of Vancouver, who had a vehicle for security reasons, as late as 1907 or 1908, virtually no one in Vancouver owned a motor vehicle. It isn't really until post-World War I that you get mass production in Canada, anyway, I don't know about the States. You don't, in this time period, you don't have mass motor vehicles. And that has all sorts of implications of how Kingsley leads his life. So how does Kingsley immigrate to Canada? It should be noted, and I think I alluded to this before, people with disabilities face barriers on immigrating to Canada today. In 2013, Canadian immigration policy is fairly hostile to people with disabilities immigrating. It's not impossible, but there's a series of barriers. How does this guy do this? In 1902, after he gives up on the States, he moves to Canada. We don't know. We think it may be that whiteness has an element. He's a white man. He may have just slipped across the border, but he doesn't lead a quiet life. What does he do? He's a radical. He founds a political party that wants to basically smash the state. That's not really inaccurate. That's more or less their program. I'm just describing the program of the Socialist Party of Canada. They want to replace the mode of production. Although it is true, so we are interested in the national security state. It ramps up tremendously after World War I. Why? Partly because Canada enters the war with England, not the US, in 1914, much earlier. And guess what? The SPC is opposed to the war. Okay, and the Canadian state doesn't really like this, as you can imagine, because they're encouraging people, although they continue with their impossibilist program, the SPC is a little more complicated. They continue to run for office, and they continue to do, even though they formally denounce reformism, so they see as acting to make capitalism better is a sop to the capitalist ruling class. That's their formal program. But in reality, they do things like oppose the war, although Kingsley himself pens an editorial complaining about German imperialism in 1914. So his position is more ambiguous, and he becomes less and less popular. He's very old at this time, and his nickname is Old Man Kingsley. By the 40s and 50s, and I think his baldness and his imposing figure, as my colleague was talking about, really does. He's a large man with a bald head. It sort of enhances the intimidation factor, shall we say. But Kingsley runs for office three times for the House of Commons in the 27 years he lives in Canada, which is our parliament, and he runs another three times for the BC legislature. He's a busy character. So Yeah, so this is, I guess, these two slides. So he also does these cross-Canada tours. And like the U.S., as I'm sure you're aware, Canada is not a small country. It's larger than the United States. So doing, I don't know how he did it. Well, to put it in perspective, although I guess I'm just telling you the bourgeois nature of my life. When you know, we're still struggling to find RAs to go to Montana to do the archival research. Because I don't want to spend my sabbatical in rural Montana riding right in a train. But Kingsley rode around on trains in 1908 from BC to Central Canada, which is a distance, the same distance as California to New York. It's thousands and thousands of miles, more or less. It's 3,000 miles. And the one big difference is, where is the Delaneists split in the United States? And then the Socialist Party of the United States has minimal influence in places like Wisconsin and Minnesota, but more or less disappears after World War II. The Impossibilists, and they call themselves that because they believe reforming capitalism is impossible, hence they're impossibilists. They actually get people elected in the British Columbia legislature. Not many, not Kingsley, but a couple of people do get elected. Okay, so they're sitting in the legislature denouncing the government all day, and they in fact cooperate. They don't really practice what they preach, probably because they'd have nothing to do if they were purely orthodox. But they did have considerable support among coal miners and metal miners, and British Columbia, like many Western states, is very working class at this time. So from the extraction industries, they were able to build an electoral base in parts of British Columbia, which the Delaneists never did, and even the Dempseyan Socialists. I mean, they had mayorships in places like Milwaukee, and certainly, the farmer laborers, before Humphrey convinced them to merge with the Democrats, the farmer laborers did have some success in some parts of Minnesota, but that's very marginal to U.S. history. By and large, the Dempseyans largely failed, so they did have some success. But the SPC is complicated in their politics. So they are normally quite aloof, and they don't necessarily get along with other forces like the IWW, but at times, so during the 1913 coal miners' strike on Vancouver Island, they formed the Miners' Liberation League. So they work with the IWW during the miners' strike. And if you know anything about mining, miners' strikes are serious business because there's a particular class consciousness about, I'm a union member, and that in itself is somewhat unusual. But I mean, being an academic union is just not the same thing as being a miner. To state the obvious, I mean, the Canadian faculty member, they go on strike, it's like, but nobody really cares. I mean, apart from students, it's not the same thing, between academic or most white collar unions, it's not the same thing. Partly because they're in company towns. So if they go on strike, they're shutting down the entire town. Everything shuts down. And then, of course, after the war, you have the famous Winnipeg General Strike of 1919. But he's known as an old man. So just give you, I think I should probably try, I'm going to try to wrap up for five. I've got a few minutes, if that'll be okay. I want to read you so you can hear some things of his own voice, just to give you a lived flavor, since you've all come out in the snowstorm to hear this. I wanted to give you some of the actual impressions so you're not just hearing me. So in one of the debates, it's Bill Pritchard, who was actually a defendant in the Winnipeg General Strike. He is a mentee of Kingsley. Kingsley has been largely forgotten, but Bill Pritchard was sent to prison for his role in the Winnipeg General Strike. So he's actually famous in Canadian labor history. He was sent to prison, I think basically for sedition or treason, for his role in the general strike, some offense like that. And he remembers Kingsley debates as he describes this. So this will give you a little bit of flavor. So he quotes Kingsley as saying, "Ladies and gentlemen, I've addressed hundreds of meetings on this side of the line and the other side of the line," i.e. the 49th parallel. "I've never felt it necessary to refer to the physical characteristics of any of my opponents, but this young squirt has taken it upon himself to make reference to my baldness, which is very obvious. I want to tell him that there are two kinds of baldness. Bald on the outside," he pointed to his head, then he pointed to the fellow and said, "bald on the inside. You can see my kind of baldness every time I take off my hat. His kind of baldness is evident every time he opens his mouth." That's one of the milder statements, okay, that Kingsley made. So he's and even people that are polemically against him. So the Delaneists trash him in the internal literature that they've lovingly kept in their archives in Wisconsin. Thank you, Delanus, for keeping all that archival material. But they, even when they're trashing him as a ridiculously sectarian and dogmatic, they all say, unlike others that are taking this position, Kingsley is of remarkable speaking ability. So everyone notices his speaking ability. But just to give you, this is from not Pritchard. This is actually from a mainstream Vancouver newspaper, mainstream capitalist press, when Kingsley is running for parliament in 1908. The headline just is entitled, "If Necessary, Let Them Use Clubs." That's the headline. So as I said, these are not reformists. And so Kingsley is quoted as saying, "Within the next 8 years, there will be the greatest upheaval on this Western continent the world has ever seen." That's interesting. He predicts the start of the First World War fairly accurately. Then he says, "And if necessary, the working classes will go forward with clubs in their hands to emphasize their needs." I hope not. But if necessary, then let them use clubs. The community as a whole must get control of the tools of production. The article also provides a glimpse into his mannerisms that left such a deep impression on audiences across the political spectrum and made him such a popular speaker. So this is a quotation. You'll see a lot of the details are wrong, which is, again, there's no real, we don't know why that's the case. It could be that Kingsley was always there illegally. We do have security documents after the war breaks out at the very, very top in Ottawa, which is the capital of Canada, at the top national security level, inquiring whether Mr. Kingsley has acquired British subject status, which sounds like a prelude to deportation. I mean, you've got a Privy Council asking the minister, does this man have naturalization? That's an alarm bell for anybody who's a lawyer. Yet he never gets deported. And all we can think about that is that after the Winnipeg General Strike breaks out, which again, American audience, you may be not familiar with, the working class seizes Winnipeg for a brief time. It looks like they just had too many other things to worry about. That Kingsley was low on the totem pole because they were trying to maintain control over a mass radicalization. And people often see soldiers as relatively conservative. But don't forget, if you have demobilization, and a lot of Kingsley's writings, he founds his own newspaper in 1919 after he's marginalized in the SPC. It only lasts 3 months. But one of the great policy debates across the political spectrum is, what do you do in Canada, and I think in the United States, with demobilized soldiers? You've had the Winnipeg General Strike. You do not want thousands of people that have had military training, that have guns, in some cases may not have given decommissioned their weapons, are coming back and now have no job. This is not, well, you see this in Vietnam. This had consequences in Vietnam much later on. But in World War I, you had the same sort of debates. And Kingsley is speaking to the soldiers, saying, you know, that this is capitalist crisis, there is no future, and soldiers should join the revolution. Government is not really thrilled to hear this. So, but let me just give you a flavor of, I'll speak another few minutes and then I'll wrap up. 1908, the newspaper says, The point I wanted to make there was, yes, you may have noticed by now, the point I was trying to make there was, it is possible that Kingsley may have been deliberately ambiguous. This goes back to the death certificate. He may have been ambiguous about his background because he may never have been in the country legally in the first place. He may have crossed the border, started running for office. And I had one of these 14 RAs research election law. And it sounds like, at least provincially, there weren't a lot of constraints in that time. But you have to remember, BC was settled fairly late, to say nothing about Montana. You know, Montana becomes a state around the time Kingsley has his accident. I think that's right. I think it's 1889. I could be wrong about that. But it's very late in the formation of the United States, Montana becomes a state. BC has a very low population in this time period, so people just want to start running for office. It changes after the war breaks up, but prior to the war, interestingly enough, the SPC attracts the most attention when it links up with South Asian radicals that were fighting for Indian independence. Interestingly, that alerts the Privy Council in London, and London gets nervous about why these SPC radicals are aligning with Indian nationals. But by and large, BC is so far away, and you live in a world where you want to go to Los Angeles. You know, you some of you could speak in Los Angeles tonight. You could just go to the airport, get off the plane. I know, you know, many academics, that's how they live their life. You get off the plane, you give your talk. You know, this is a time period where distance matters. But, okay, with that, I just want to give you this description. So Kingsley is described in 1908 in the newspaper account. This is the mainstream newspaper, as a typical American who's 15 years residence in Canada. See, this part's wrong. See, he's just, you know, at this point, he had only been in Canada for about 6 years. Has not spoiled his accent. He speaks in short sentences and drives them at his audience with sharp forward jerks of his head. But the most curious of his mannerisms is the way, when wishing to make a point, he licks his first finger for all the world like a baseball pitched preparing the famous spitball. Tall and inclined to be stout, with keen small eyes that seem to be continually raking his audience for possible hecklers, he is a good speaker with a forceful manner. 1916, he writes his one and only book with a colleague, or comrade, Petty Peace, and that is on chattel slavery. And again, just a sort of a nice way to end the talk, if you don't mind, with a little, this is from his 1916 book, which you could certainly order by interlibrary loan if you ever had the desire to read this. He says, "The most reckless indifference to the welfare of the slaves of industry is manifested throughout the entire employing world, and not the slightest safeguard is afforded the lives and limbs of the workers." This is a man who's had his limbs amputated. So, am I reading back something that isn't there? I don't know. There's just no way of knowing, but it's suggestive. You know, that's what we do as scholars. We find little things and hope it sticks. You know, we don't know. But not the slightest safeguard is afforded the lives and limbs of the workers if it can in any way be avoided. Politicians, professors, and press writers lie like horse thieves about mundane matters, while pulpiteers weave entrancing fables about the heavenly beyond for the purpose of chloroforming slaves into forgetting their chains and meekly submitting to the continuation of the crucifixion upon the altar of ruling class plunder. Okay, so this is not Eugene Debs, this is not Jesse Jackson, this is sort of really hardcore revolutionary radicalism. The book uses the history and structures of exploitation from antiquity to the present day to analyze capitalism, and written without any footnotes, it falls within the tradition of popular education of blue-collar laborers, and this was a fundamental cornerstone of the SBC philosophy. So in my last minute, you know, as I said, I can go on for hours. I have a lot more to say. You know, we can do that in question period. I do want to mention there, and I have to credit Professor Mark Lear, who brought this to the attention of Ben Eisen and I, is The Gleaming Archway, which those of you that are of a literary bent, or theory is just too boring or too, you know, and you want to enjoy your life or enjoy your families, you just want to read fiction, we believe there is a fictional portrayal, we're almost 100% positive, of Kingsley in a novel called The Gleaming Archway that bizarrely, which just helps my career randomly, was released, re-released after decades in 2012. It wasn't even re-released when we started this, but it's out again, and you can buy The Gleaming Archway. Not that good as a novel. It's one of these very cheesy proletarian novels, but it's definitely a portrayal of Kingsley. The guy's name is Casey. He's called the old man. He has an amputation. He's founded a newspaper. It's definitely Kingsley, and it's all about this man who meets Kingsley. And the man himself seems to be Stephen. He seems to put himself, because A.M. Stephen's middle name is Maitland, the protagonist's name is Maitland, there's nothing post-structuralist about that. It's all very transparent, proletarian literature, but it's interesting, and The Gleaming Archway, you know, it's there, it's amusing, and maybe literary scholars will be interested in our book too. It's like one, it's another angle of this never-ending angle, and this is just some of them. Kingsley pops up in many different ways, but what is his legacy in my last minute? What does he leave us with? In terms of a disability theory, you know, we're working on that, okay, in terms of what it says about the politics of disablement, but it's certainly an example, like Helen Keller, that gets us away from these boring Christopher Reeve sort of narratives of disability as courage in this conventional way. This is certainly a radical, lived an unconventional life. I don't know what he would have thought of the social model, but there is a debate about where his politics goes after the SPC collapses. He runs in 1926, right before his death, 3 years before his death, with a different party. Some people think he was moving to the right, but his 1919 paper, I don't have time to get into here, is just as radical as some of the other stuff. You know, he's talking after the Russian Revolution breaks out. We're still not entirely clear what he thought about Lenin's Russia, but it continues to be extremely radical. And so he leaves us with this sort of uncompromising legacy, which is the slogan of the Socialist Party of Canada: no compromise, no political training. That was his watchword. That was the life of E.T. Kingsley. Thank you very much.